As you can probably tell from the title of this video, we are going to make some tea. Going to do it slightly differently from how I normally would. Obviously, if you are a tea drinker, generally the way you would make it would be to use tea bags in a teapot or just in a cup and make it that way. We're actually going to use some loose tea and the cafetiere. Remember from my ASMR coffee video, we made coffee that way by grinding the beans and then using the cafetiere French press to press down and extract all that goodness from the coffee. Now you can do the same thing with tea. I've actually never done it before because obviously using a tea bag is just way easier, but actually intrigued to see how this goes and whether or not there is a taste difference between that type of tea and the kind of regular tea that I drink. But before we do this, let me just move this out of the way. I thought I'd go through some of the types of tea that I drink. So, being obviously someone who's English, British, I guess. We drink a lot of tea in this country. Generally, we'll drink what's called the kind of like English breakfast tea, which is this kind of fairly mild tea. We'll have it with milk. Some people have it with sugar. And that's generally the gist of things. My preferred tea is Earl Grey. And that's what we're going to be using today. This is actually some of Sainsbury's own brand Earl Grey. I don't really have a preference on brands or anything like that, but it seems like it was fairly decent. And this is the loose leaf tea that we're going to use. Earl Grey has this kind of slightly like almost perfume quality to it. The smell is this kind of like rich one, and it's got this kind of slightly like nutty taste as well, compared to regular tea, which I personally prefer. And I prefer to, I mean, one of the reasons why I drink it is because I really like it with just milk, which a lot of people say is a travesty with Earl Grey. A lot of people will drink it with a slice of lemon. That's disgusting to me. But one of the reasons why I actually drink more Earl Grey nowadays as well is because I generally have sugar with my, you know, what the regular tea that, you know, you'd normally drink. And so, like, it's just healthier to have Earl Grey for me because I prefer it without sugar. So that's the way. Obviously, every now and then I'll have just a regular cup of tea or something like that, but yeah, I really like Earl Grey. That's just a thing. So we'll have a look at that in a bit. Other types of tea that I drink as well. We've got some here, which is some licorice and peppermint tea bags. This is by a company called Tea Pigs, who make really, really nice tea. Licorice and peppermint is quite, as you kind of would imagine, I guess, in a way, a fairly sweet tea. It's, you don't have it with milk or sugar or anything like that. And as you can see, it's caffeine free, so it's nice to have kind of like in bed or just before you go to bed as something that's not going to disrupt your sleep, basically. And it tastes really nice as well. If you're like thinking of trying out different types of tea, I definitely recommend licorice and peppermint. It's got that minty side of it as well. The licorice isn't like overpowering, so don't worry if you're like, oh no, I can't stand the licorice, but it's well worth giving it a try anyway. And if I just get out one of the tea bags, you can see smells great. And yeah, it's one of my favorite teas for sure. so good for you, so good for you. I don't know if that's actually the case or not. I don't know if there's actually real studies in that, but I quite like it, and it's a nice kind of, it's one of those very, I find anyway, like a refreshing kind of tea, you know. It's not heavy at all. This one comes with mint. I don't personally like green tea just on its own, it's very bitter, but with mint on the side of it, it's just takes that edge off it, I think, as well. And hey, if it's good for you as well, then that's a bonus. If it's not, it just kind of tastes nice, I guess. I think in a way, like, a tea like that is good for you, because in my case, generally if I'm drinking like a cup of tea, I'm not drinking any soda, so that's good for me in that case, you know. And you can have a look at the tea bag here. You can just see it's if it focuses in. Is it going to do that? There we go. Okay, so you've got yeah, like all the kind of loose. This one's obviously a little bit finer with the green tea than it is with one as well. So yeah, they're the kind of two other types of tea which I drink as well. Just I think the green tea does contain caffeine, by the way, just in case you did wonder. So yeah, they're the other types of kind of tea I drink as well. I wouldn't say I am hugely prolific in the amount of tea I drink. I probably have like, I don't know, 4 cups a day, which isn't prolific, believe me, in the UK, but it's probably round about average, I'd say, on there. But yeah, let's, I guess, get started with making our actual tea. Got a slightly different camera angle today as well. Let's try that out, see how that works. There's our cup, a bit more of a kind of like top down kind of version. So says to use like one wow, just get the smell from that. It's actually really strong. It's pretty cool. It says to use 1 teaspoon per cup. So I figure if I just use what was the coffee spoon there, that should kind of constitute it out. I did wash it from when I used it last time. It's very important to wash your cafetiere, because I think I said this last time, but especially if you're using it for coffee, like coffee goes mouldy really quickly, like compacted coffee grains. It's very good for composting, actually, if you are into that sort of thing, but believe me, it does. Where I work, we actually have a coffee machine that uses like coffee grounds, and like if someone isn't emptying that bin out like every day, then that's a bad job. Okay. Okay, so I figure like that's essentially how much I need to put in there, if you like. Just 1 spoonful, we'll try it out. I'm not a big fan of like great, crazy strong tea. So prefer it to be there, but what we'll do is we'll kind of like cut away. When we come back, I'll fill it up. with some boiling water and we can get brewing. So I'll be back in a minute. Okay, so let's add the water. I've got the water in a cup actually, so I hope I can add it properly. Let's just move some of this out of the way. It's a bit fiddly because I have to I'm using the camera, so I am spilling it, but it's okay. It's only boiling water, don't worry. There we go. And yeah, you can just about see the tea leaves swirling around in there. Looks pretty cool actually. Let's put the top on so that we keep some of the heat in there. And then you have to leave it for 2-3 minutes, I think. Let's have a look on the packet, which they probably tell me 3 to 5 minutes. So while we do that, I will just bring up some interesting information about tea, in case you were wondering. So tea actually originates in like Asia. China, India are the two biggest kind of manufacturers of tea in the world. That's where the saying for all the tea in China comes from. When someone says like, oh, I wouldn't do that for all the tea in China, that's like a known expression. And so you might be like, well, how did this become like the national beverage of the UK? Well, back in the kind of like, so I mean, first origins of tea is from apparently like 2700 BC, which is a long, long time ago in China. That's the first kind of like recorded information they've had about tea. And yeah, I think it was like the 17th century that is the first recorded kind of 1615 apparently is from a guy called Richard Wickham, who ran the East India Company office in Japan, and he wrote about this kind of beverage that he tried, and it was amazing. And then by 1657 tea was being sold in coffee houses in London, and it was this really expensive like luxury commodity that only the rich and, you know, the kind of real nobles were drinking. And like, they did have green and black tea. So if you don't know what the difference between green and black tea is, you might be like, well, you know, why is it called green and black? Well, there's kind of like different types of tea. So green tea leaves are kind of like, as you would imagine, they're kind of like the fresher, they're unwilted basically, they're unoxidized as well, whereas black tea leaves are wilted, they're fully oxidized as well. Black tea, as we think of it in the UK, is actually referred to as red tea in China, and then they have this kind of green tea that is like fermented, which is called black tea in China. Kind of is red, you see it there, so it does kind of make sense. I think the Chinese have probably got that right, but to be fair, we're not going to be changing anytime soon, so it's been like that for quite some time. So yeah, as I said, it was kind of like around the 17th century. Then in the 18th century was when it became a bit more widely consumed. It was heavily taxed by the British government, and there was like this whole kind of tea smuggling thing going on, which kind of led the general public to be able to afford and drink tea. And it's kind of one of those classic things where the public, they start to drink it because it became so popular, you know, with the nobles. And then so like it kind of filtered down, you know, and people thought they were, very kind of posh drinking it. Also tastes damn good, I suppose, as well. And then yeah, by the late 18th century, the tax on it was abolished, and so it became like a very common drink. And by the time of the late 19th century, it was just everywhere, basically. That's the way it goes. And that's what we've kind of seen from there as a whole. Now, tea was originally only really grown in China, but the British actually introduced it to China to try to break that monopoly. Sorry, they introduced it to India, sorry, to break that monopoly that China had. For those who don't know, like back in like the 1840s, which is when they did it, Great Britain spanned a lot of countries across the world, and India was one of those. So they basically controlled India and kind of started growing it there. And now, India is one of the largest producers of tea in the world. China is still number one, but I think I had some numbers here, which is that China produce around about 1.9 million tons of tea each year, and India around about 1.2. So as you can see, they're kind of catching up pretty quick. And a lot of other countries do make tea as well. Kenya, Sri Lanka, again, both countries which were introduced to tea by the UK, funnily enough. And then you have Vietnam, Turkey, Iran, Indonesia, Argentina, Japan. It's interesting that, like, different countries across the world, you know, you've got South American countries there, obviously Asian, you have kind of like Asian European in Turkey, you have more Middle East in Iran, and you have African in like Kenya. It's interesting that there's this big kind of like different change of countries around the world which do actually make tea. It's pretty cool. But obviously the UK does not make tea, so there you go. I think we're about brewed, so shall we? I think it's time to put the plunger down. Let's try it. There we go. It's looking okay. It might come across a little bit weak. I don't know. We'll see how it goes. But let's pour it here. Traditionally, you would just consume tea in a mug. You know, that's just the way of things. It's almost more comforting to just have the mug, you know, there. Big mug of tea at all times. Obviously, I've got it in this kind of like dainty little cup right now. I'm going to just try it without any milk and see how it is. Yeah, it's very nice actually. That is good. That's actually just about right, I think. Then I'll add a little bit of milk because I am an absolute philistine. So if you don't know, Grey adds a spice called bergamot to it, which is where the kind of perfume smell comes from, which I really like. There you go, you can see it's got a little bit more, colour to it now, I guess. That's the business, that's nice. There we have ourselves a nice cup of tea. So I'm not sure I would go through that whole process just to make myself a small cup like that when I can add a tea bag in, but I guess for the purposes of this video, it's actually pretty nice to do that. And it's interesting, for those of you who don't perhaps live in the UK and don't, you obviously may know that it's actually fairly rare for people to buy tea in coffee shops as well. Usually tea is something which people make themselves because it's easy, whether they're at work or at home. And, you know, you don't see that much tea actually being made or consumed at coffee shops at all. It's more of a thing you do when you get home. Just become this real kind of like comfort drink, I guess, over the years. People always talk about the kind of memes of, you know, having a cup of tea and everything's going to be okay. But there is something very comforting about tea, especially if you've had a hard day at work. You come home and you just want to relax. And, I think it's the process of making the tea as well. It's fairly quick. And, you know, you can just pop the tea bag in a cup, pour the hot water on, add your milk and sugar as you wish. And then you're there, you know. And it's that kind of process as well, which is kind of fairly comforting. And the fact that it happens in a few minutes, whereas unless you were using instant coffee, if you're making coffee, it would take a little bit longer to do as well. So it's interesting that, like, around the world, people have such different takes on their kind of like drink, you know, the hot drink, I suppose, that they consume. Even with tea, like, in different countries, it's consumed in many, many different ways, and different variations and different varieties and things like that, you know. So it is kind of very interesting. But you'd think, like, maybe if you come to the UK, you'd probably think, like, oh, they drink a lot of tea, so we're going to see, like, tea houses, like you would see coffee houses. But actually, there is no such thing. There are many, many, many coffee shops in the UK, and there are very, very, very few tea shops in the UK, because it's just become something which, whereas with coffee, you need, well, I mean, you don't necessarily need, but coffee generally is thought to improve, you know, when by using, like, things like espresso machines, which are very expensive, and obviously different types and different variations on it, and the way people make it as well. There's a whole kind of barista art to it, where with tea, you just drop it back in a teapot, so people are a little bit kind of like against, you know, paying, you know, whereas people will pay like £3 for a coffee, they're very much against paying more than like a pound for a cup of tea. So it's not really a very profitable venture to open a tea house, I'd say. But I think that's where we're going to wrap it up. So thank you so much for watching, as always. It's always my pleasure to do these.